Joshua. So let's talk a little bit of, like I was telling you, about cloud, about disaster recovery, and the problem models you've become expert in. The first question I would have basically is, what is the business impact of cloud in a disaster recovery program? Because everyone talks about the benefits of cloud in general, software as a service, infrastructure as a service, but as far as disaster recovery, what is the impact?
It's a very interesting question, because the impact of disaster recovery, specifically in regards to the cloud, is actually very dramatic. It's one of the top service offerings that most of the analysts have recognized as being the most impactful. The reason being is the traditional model for disaster recovery, where you would set up a second data center, purchase a second set of servers, replicate data, incredibly costly. It's a traditional model, it's been done for 20 to 30 years, and it works very well, but the resources from a cost and a people perspective are tremendous. The cloud completely changes that. And what we've seen over the past few years is that the technologies that are being used remove virtually all the cost from that, increase features, increase capabilities, and allow organizations and businesses to really allow their IT groups to focus more on what they need to focus on, which is the business, rather than the GR plans. So leveraging both disaster recovery in the cloud or DRAS, disaster recovery as a service, which is very commonly referred to, it drives tremendous benefit, cost, simplicity. It literally takes the requirement for organizations to either own VR programs and pushes it off to a service provider that has the experience to do it. So it's pretty dramatic.
We're living in times where the uptime is 99.999999%.
Absolutely.
And cloud sometimes has a few questions around it as far as uptime and availability. What do you say about that?
So I would argue that uptime needs to be 100%. That's what everybody should drive for. It's not realistic. That's a very difficult thing. One of the very interesting comparisons is taking a look at the security and the availability of on-prem equipment, how companies address their own disaster recovery, and then comparing that to how cloud providers address their own security. And what you see is a stark difference between the investment level that a company puts into their own security and that of a cloud provider. So as an example, within a single organization that has set up a disaster recovery site, they usually have 2 to 3 people managing experts within that environment, and they spend whatever they need to spend to segregate and to set up that environment. When you look at a cloud provider, Columbus Networks as an example, a very large provider in the region, they have hundreds of people. They have support groups. They have not 1 or 2 network engineers. They have a massive team of network engineers. So when it comes to uptime, what's very interesting is the uptime of cloud providers and of data centers and of larger service providers is significantly better. May not be 100%, that's what we all drive for, but it's significantly better than what an internal organization is actually able to do themselves alone. What tricks us most of the time is that outages at a cloud provider are very visible.
Yeah.
So whenever Microsoft or Google or Amazon has a 10-minute or 20-minute outage, it impacts a huge number of companies. But it's 10 to 20 minutes, and it gets a few hours, and everybody talks about it. And then, is the cloud secure? What's the availability of that? The reality is, if you look at the comparison to internal environments, outages last days, and it's incredibly costly. So there's yes, there'll be outages on both sides, but at a cloud provider, it's more secure.
I'm going to ask a question you're probably going to ask 1,000 times a day. Security,
yes.
Data privacy, as far as you have a mirror data center, and then there's your whole information, there's your critical data, the most important company secrets, everything. How do you handle that as far as the DRAS model?
Sure. Another That is one of the top questions that I get asked, and I typically answer that by asking one more question, and that's to the organization. I've asked them, have you ever had an employee leave that had data security access? What's the response? Well, many, many over time. And how do you secure that data? All of a sudden, start to think about, well, they try very hard, they change passwords, but the reality is the internal knowledge about the network operations does leave with that employee that moves too. So when it comes to securing your own servers and securing cloud servers, again, I'm going to say when you have 2,000 people monitoring your network environment, and that is the only thing they do, that's their business, you get better performance, you get better capability at the end of that. So cloud providers, their sole business is to provide a secure data center environment. If you look at companies like Google as an example, massive investment. I mean, we're talking billions of dollars, really, like actual billions of dollars in network infrastructure, in data security, data protection. Nobody can match that on-prem. So you end up with very significant differences between kind of privacy and security. Having said that, the public cloud, where your data resides, is something you can consider. You can't ignore that at all. But that's public cloud. When you look at private cloud deployments, similar to in-network service providers like Columbus as an example, they own their own cloud, they own their own network, and they're able to tell you exactly where that data resides. So data residency and privacy issues are addressed by decide which clouds you need to actually
put. How can organizations prepare and also leverage the VRAS model today? What do you think are the main steps to take?
Yeah, absolutely. The first thing is the network. And that's always what trips up organizations. They believe they can leverage the cloud, they can move their servers into the cloud, their data back into the cloud. If they don't have a reliable network and sufficient bandwidth, it's not are going to be disappointed. And I would say 50% of the companies that, maybe more, that move to a cloud model forget the network. So the first step really is to make sure you have a very solid, very reliable, very sufficient network. The next step is to define which services or which applications, which servers within your environment are the appropriate ones to move. A lot of people say, move the entire thing. I don't. It's not realistic to say move your entire IT organization. You can move over time, that's possible, but you need to move bits and pieces in the cloud. So deciding which applications are prime, are ready to be moved into the cloud, which ones need data residency, which ones need privacy, which ones do you need to be able to go into the server room and see control or patch. Those are going to help you find what you need to the cloud and which network. So it's really defining which server and which applications need to move in what order.
Mm-hmm. I was reading a statistic that really surprised me. It's that by 2018, the number of organizations using DRS will be larger than the number of organizations using the traditional infrastructure. Why do you think? That's the first question. And as far as Latin America, I don't know if you have any knowledge of our region, is that moving as fast in our region as it is in the States, Europe, and such?
That statistic is very real. I believe that actually
can confirm.
It is. It's very, very well recognized. And the reason it's so important and everybody needs to understand this is if you go to a conference today, a conference right outside of this room, you see all the different technology providers. All of them are going to be talking about the cloud. They're going to have a cloud program. They're going to talk about their cloud services, their cloud capabilities. What's very important is to recognize what they're not talking about. They're not talking about their traditional models. They're not talking about selling equipment. They're talking about selling services. When the entire technology industry moves in a different direction, companies have no choice. So if IBM, HP, Sunbar, Dell, and all the other companies are talking about how they need to evolve into a cloud model, you know that they're going to be talking to their customers about a cloud model too, which means they're not going to be focused on their traditional model. So that has started happening in the past 2 years, to the point of where Gartner now says, within 2 to 3 years, there's going to be more services delivered as in the cloud than there would be on-prem model. In regards to your second question, what we're actually seeing is an either yes or no answer to migrate to the cloud in the Latin American markets. In the US and Europe, there's more of a comfort level with the cloud. And so because of that, they're picking and choosing which services and which groups of technology will be. In Latin America, I'm seeing more of a focus of if they agree with the cloud model and they find a service provider that they're comfortable with and that works for them, they'll move everything, which is a challenge. It's a big step forward, but it's I haven't seen little steps. I've seen people close their days and say, well, we're moving to the cloud. We decided to do that. So I think what we'll see over the next year or two is a massive migration from an on-prem model to a cloud model. A great example is DRAM's conference I was attending and speaking at yesterday, and the room was packed. Every single seat was paid, and that's a surprise, because most of the time, if it's not a specific topic that people are looking for, you get bits and pieces of attendance. Every seat is paid, and that goes to show that how people leverage the cloud and the DRAS model is very important. They have to understand it, and they recognize. So I think over the next year or two, it's going to be a massive change.
You help conceptualize DRAS portfolios for public cloud vendors and also private cloud vendors.
Yes.
Like Columbus, I guess. Tell me a little bit about your experience. Where do you start? Because you were talking about how these vendors have a huge advantage as far as being their offer because they're focused on that. Tell me a little bit about that.
What's very interesting is each service provider brings very unique capabilities to the offer, and they really, everybody has a different flavor of cloud and flavor of services that are there on top of it. We helped them launch their DRAS program, so we're very familiar with what a public cloud looks like from a DRAS perspective. It's very much a hands-on model. They're equipping customers with tools and capabilities to go do it themselves. And for some organizations, that's perfect and that works well. And because of that, you get cost efficiencies. It's probably cheaper to run in a public cloud. However, when you look at clouds or a private cloud or a hybrid cloud, what you get with it is huge services and really significant capabilities and assistance in migrating and managing. It's delivered as a managed service. One of the interesting things is that Gartner actually released a Magic Quadrant report several months ago on specifically DRAS. Columbus was highlighted in a very incredibly strong position within that DRAS report. And one of the areas that all of the other service providers in is customer service. And so the ranking or the response put them up incredibly high. Now that's really important because if you compare that to public cloud vendors, they probably would have scored very low because they're not designed to help the companies migrate or go in that direction, whereas Columbus would.
Yeah. And what else have you been working on with Columbus?
So we're looking at expanding their DRAS suite to cover off a broader range of applications. DRAS is not just about replicating the data in the cloud, it's about efficiency while you're operating the cloud. So recognizing that once you've embraced the cloud model and you're now protecting your data into the cloud, how are you going to be operate in the cloud if you fail over. Maybe you should stay in the cloud. So we're working on technologies and partnerships and alliances that allow that product portfolio to gain and keep growing.
What kind of applications do you have in the DRS model?
Almost everything. So there's at this stage, there's enough technology out there to migrate virtually all technologies or else to the cloud.
It's interesting because it breaks up the usual model you have of disaster recovery, right?
Absolutely.
It's just the mirror data center and that's it.
And that, you're right. That's a very traditional model. Everybody's comfortable with that model. Change doesn't come quick when people are comfortable. However, in the next year or two, when those companies call their traditional vendors and they talk about maintenance programs or upgrades or updates, and those traditional vendors say, we sunset that, we don't use that anymore, we can't provide support for that, you're going to have to upgrade, that's when the comfort stops. And that's when they're going to have to start looking at more of a service provider and capabilities around.
That's hard for vendors. So as far as the region, it's been hard, the transition from the traditional infrastructure to the service model. And what do you think are the key factors that make it successful for always traditional vendors, please? Let's go something like that. We used to sell the server and everything into the service.
Sure. It's one of the biggest problems. It's the traditional market is comfortable and selling the traditional technology. The key for them is to understand that service delivery model is more of an ongoing relationship and helping the customer. So you start to see a huge focus around the system engineers and not just salespeople, but really partners to help local organizations understand what the best use of the cloud is and how they can do it. So a lot of the traditional vendors, I would say, are having significant issues. Some of the large vendors are having very, very significant issues. And they're actually acquiring companies just to get that capability so that they're able to talk about having a cloud, talk about a service. We've seen this everywhere.
Yeah.
You see HP split into two different companies so that they can become more than one. You see IBM buying software for billions of dollars.
I mean, and getting rid of their server.
Sure, correct. You know, they just love their services. And because of that, those companies are having a lot more difficulty in embracing the model, and they're having substantial difficulty. Whereas for nimble players, a Columbus, for example, that focuses on services, you can see if you look at the Gartner Magic Quadrant and you look at the responses, the response between them and some of the largest telcos are night and day. They score 100% of the customer response, whereas some of the other vendors didn't quite the opposite.
Yeah, it's quite a change. It's accelerating for the industry right now.
It absolutely is.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Joshua. Thank you for talking a little bit with us.
Absolutely, my pleasure.
Coming to Guatemala from Honduras in this generation.
My pleasure. Thank you so much.
Muchas gracias. Manténganse en revista Andino.